principles been slightly effective. But after 1 to 20 days, you see the spanica, you can see the mortality is reduced from the previous, but you can see that we still have a moderate mortality for air protectors. The LC50 values were between 0.18 and 0.38. And when you go to Eucalyptus aligna, so there was also the same trend with the same index. After 120 days, that is the storage duration of most grain in East Africa, we still see that there is still some slight effects on the air protectors, and LC50 values were between 0.04 to 0.70% volume by weight. Those are the same results compared. This is the Cirrus Arabica. The percentage mortality and concentration, and also this is the same. You can see that the Ficus crenum is still at the lowest, and the protectors moderate. And that is also the results for East Aligna. Sorry, the results after 120 days for Cirrus Arabica. You can see the protectors is still up, and these other insects are still low. But though there is some slight difference here with the SCMAs. When you come to the city of repellents, the repellents values were very low, except in the Tripolium castrena in both boys. And this one is interesting because when you look at the toxicity on the other side, is that Tripolium castrenum is normally toralan, essential oils. But when you see here repellents, it looks like they have some slight effect when it comes to repellents. So those are the same results from here, 30 days and 120 days for Cirrus Arabica essential oil. And those are the results also compared for East Aligna essential oil for 30 days here and 120 days. And some conclusion and recommendation is that when you look at the both oils, you find that when it comes to the symptom toxicity, it is moderately effective against the protectors. When it comes to residual repellents, it moderately repels the castrenum. And we can just conclude here that the EOs may not be reliable for long-term storage of grains the way they are. Something has to be done, and we need probably to improve the formulation, so slow-release formulation for long-term storage, probably for 4 months and beyond. And we are already pursuing these issues. Somebody talked about an international organization to deal with the pesticide plant technologies. We are already on it in Kenya. We have already formed a network, which is an NGO. And our goal is to improve agricultural productivity amongst all of the farmers through development, protection, dissemination of pesticide plant technologies. This brings together farmers, farmer organizations, the private sector, and also research and academic institutions. Acknowledgements. We have wished to acknowledge Figueres and Acosti and Richardson University for providing financial support for this study, and ECPE for providing analytical equipment, Natural Resources Institute for sponsoring us to come here, and also the organizers for this conference. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you very much. We have time for the questions. I did get that. Once to your point there, we can hear from you.
We were talking about a possible novel technology for slow release of your essential oils, and maybe you, me, and Joshua, perhaps Steve Valdane, should have a talk afterwards, because I think we've got a couple of ideas. Sounds like a good plan.
Thank you for some good presentation. But my question, also there is other presenters, like the guy from Malawi, to say that, as you say yourself, for further analysis overseas or in other countries, what transfer agreements do you use? Thank you.
For us as an institution, I think we have a policy of dealing with research projects. We have a research policy on issues that touches on materials. We also have laws in Kenya that touches on transfer of materials. This is a protocol.
Thank you once again. Then we can move on. We now go to. Thank you. You saved a bit of time. We now move on to Prophet. Prophet is going to talk about the Cameroonian insecticidal products from Asgaragla, Kenya. And Lanros. This is for the protection of cowpeas and maize against the storage pests. Today is looking very different from yesterday.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Morning to all. The opportunity is given to me to present today. The Cameroonian insecticidal product from Asgaragla indica and the Cactus granulosus for the protection of store cowpea and maize against Cyclophilus cinemes and Capsocrocus mongolatus. The one challenge is to feed 9 billion people by 2015. And as we know, developing countries are leaders in food insecurity, mostly in sub-Saharan countries, where Cameroon is facing the same difficulties. So, to increase food production is not enough. There's a need also to reduce pre and post harvest losses, because we know without protection, people are looking for insects. Cowpea and maize are the staple food in Cameroon. As you can see, the cowpea and maize are cultivated all around the territory of the country and are highly damaged, with a rate of 25% damage. So when we estimate the cost of damage for the cowpea with 25% damage, we have $33 million of US dollars. And for the maize, when we observe, we have $0.9 billion US dollars. That is what is lost in Cameroon. So what is the solution? Farmers are stakeholders using different methods. And the widely used method in Cameroon is the use of synthetic chemicals, which is more hazardous because the electricity of the population and also the bad habit of those synthetic chemicals. So now we have interest on plant products, and in North Cameroon we have the Cactus granulosus, and Azadirata Indica, which are widely available, as farmers have started to use. But we have asked ourselves, as new products is known for their efficacy against pest insects, why not introduce it in population behavior for the protection of maize and cowpea? At the same time, Pelagrosis, which is considered as spices in Cameroon, they also have an interest for the protection of maize and cowpea. Therefore, we went to see what is the problem. The first problem that we identified with Azadirachta indica, during the harvesting and drying, is a problem of contamination by aflatoxins. And also, during this drying period, there's a problem of photo degradation and thermal degradation of the main compound, which is Azadirachta A. And then, its bioactivity to insect and to human is reduced. Also, we ask ourselves that as the Azadirachta A degradation is done rapidly during drying regime, it is also important to see how this degradation may be occurred with the treated grains. Then the objective of our study is to determine the effect of drying regimes on the insecticidal activity of oil and powder of Azadirachta indica, as well as the powder of the Pelagranthus granulosus. And then, to see the degradation of Azadirachta A in cowpea and maize over time. For that, we collected the neem seeds. We had different drying regimes. Part of the seeds were dried shaped, and part were dried under the sun. The same thing we have done with kernels. We removed the gut, and then the kernel also were dried. After that, we obtained oils and powder according to the different drying conditions. The Pelagranthus granulosus leaves were collected and then dried as we obtained powders. Then the substance that we use cowpea granulated from Peru as the new variety is the Cardino. This variety was chosen because of their high susceptibility to the respective insects, which are Isopropus macrolanthus and Cyclophilus gravis. For the biology, concerning the adult mortality, we have chosen different concentration of oil and powder, and then we mix 50 grams of maize or cowpea with products. Later on, we introduce adult insects, and mortality counts were done 1, 3, 7, and 14 days for Cyclophilus gravis, and then 1, 3, and 6 days for Gastrocrocus macrolanthus. After removal of accounts of adult mortality, we went to see the progeny production. We removed powders from the grains, and then we left for certain times, and then progeny count was done. Concerning the degradation of Azadirachta A in cowpea and maize, we took 50 grams of grains and then mixed with oil at certain concentration. Then we store it at a different period of time. 5 grams of grains was taken and then we analyzed through HPS coupled with mass to see how the degradation of Azadirachta A was. As so we did some data analysis. As a result, we noticed first that the yield of oils, when the oil were dry, the seeds of under the sun, we have less oil that was extracted. And also, for the Azadirachta A, We have noticed that when the seed were sown dry, we have less amount of energy achieved in it. Because with the seeds, you will not have any difference according to the dry regimes. Concerning now the adult mortality, we notice that on the cytophilic stages, there is no difference of dry regimes according to the mortality of adult insects. Yes, the mortality is increasing with the exposure and also with the content of the blood oil applied. The similar trend was observed also with Calcobroncus macularis. But when we use the seed owner, we notice that on Calcobroncus macularis, the new seed owner was less effective in regard of the dry regimes. Yes, this low activity is also related to the behavior of the Calcobroncus macularis, as we know that the adult of this insect are no fit, and most of the effect of new products is not according to their antifilant property. Now, concerning the efficacy of characteristic infection tuberculosis, we notice that on Calcobroncus macularis, the powder of infection tuberculosis was less effective, and so with the highest doses that we use, 50 grams of powder per kilogram, we notice that less than 50% adult mortality were obtained. Yes. On cytophilus image, we had with the highest doses 100% mortality. This means that infectious tuberculosis is more efficient to protect maize than cowpea. Now, concerning the progeny in tissue, we realize that whereas the new seed program was less effective to heal adults, but it was more effective to protect the grain against the proliferation of progeny. The same thing also was observed with the Calcobroncus tuberculosis. When we use the highest dose, we realized that this is the inhibition of progeny production. The same thing was observed with cytophilus remains. We realized that progeny inhibition were more effective with Calcobroncus tuberculosis than on Calcobroncus macularis. So, now concerning the degradation of azadiractin A concentrated cowpea and maize with neem oil, we realized that on cowpea, when we treated with neem oil, the azadiractin A stable for about 14 days and then start to degrade, and at the end remain something like 0.2 milligram per kilogram. The same thing is also observed for maize, but on maize we have the azadiractin that the content remains the same until 21 days and then start to degrade and remain something like 0.2 milligram per kilogram after 6 months. So we realized that with this slow degradation of azadiractin A, so it is important to protect our product with it, so for a long-term storage. As conclusion, we can say that the azadiractin uric acid oil was more active towards both insect species than the powder, with not significant influence of the drying regimes. And also, the leaf powder of Calcobroncus tuberculosis were more effective on cytophilus remains than on Calcobroncus macularis. So the progeny emergence was totally suppressed when azadiractin indica products were used as for the oil at the dose of 3 milliliters per kilogram and powder at the dose of more than above 10 grams a kilogram. And also the degradation of rate of azadirachtin A show a similar trend for both commodity with roughly 0.2 gram per kilogram remaining with the smallest extended dose of oil. And for the future, we have to go through the investigation on the acceptability of new product by local farmer, because we know that new products are bitter and farmer sometimes refusing to treat their pests for the product protection. So we need to do some investigation, and this work we have started already, and so we have received favorable response from the farmers. And also we want to see the influence of treating soil grains with azadirachtin indica and Precanthus granulosis on the quality characteristic of the grains, because sometimes it can affect the quality of the grains. And also we want in the future to see the stability of azadirachtin A for treated grains as influenced by natural condition. So we cannot finish present this work without acknowledging the help of the structure. We are thankful for the Federal Institute of Cultivated Plants, Germany, and also the University of Greenwich, which through the Natural Resource Institute, which provides us the possibility to be here, and then the organizer of the second International Congress of Pesticidal Plants. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Tofa. We have time for a few questions.
My name is Abel Siribuwa. I've looked at the rest that you used, and the highest is 40. Is it percent weight by weight, or what is it?
No, 40% is 40 gram per kilogram. That means the rate of 4%.
4%?
Yeah.
Because when you put it as 40, and this is a little bit misleading.
Establish cohorts of your insects that you use in the lab, and what was the age of the insects and what was the ratio of people?
The age of the insects, concerning the Parsococcus maculatus, they were 1 day old, and for Cytophilus remains, they were between 7 and 14 days old. And for the ratio is about 1 male for female.
All right. Thank you very much, Professor. Round of applause. We now go to Simon Okeche, who's going to talk about insecticidal and insect productive inhibition capacities of citrus fields, powder, against Olia Tania.
To see how it could also be used. That is the major reason behind this investigation, which is aimed at looking at the insecticidal practices of citrus peels in the management of carbon infestation. Now, various citrus were used citrus sinensis, citrus reticulata, citrus limon, and citrus paradisi, as orange, tangerine, lemon, grape, and lime, as orangifolia, were peeled using a sharp knife, and the peels were sheet dried naturally until they were crispy dry. Powder was prepared by grinding each of the citrus peels separately in a sterilized electric grinder, and then passed through a mesh size of 0.5 millimeter to obtain fine and uniform samples. The resulting plant powders were stored separately in white transparent containers with level and kept at ambient laboratory temperature prior to use. Collection and preparation of maize grain. Based on field count precisely were obtained from the markets. All maize seeds were inspected and separated to avoid mixing the corn that had already been infested with DKSNO. The resultant uninfested corns were then disinfected by open drying at 40 degrees Celsius for 4 hours. Insect culture. Culture of the test insect was raised from naturally infested maize grains. Bought from much market in Calabar Cross River State. The wounds were reared on uninfested maize under fluctuating temperature between 25 and 30 degrees Celsius in the laboratory inside a white transparent container and covered with mesh net to permit ventilation. That's safe. The pulverized plant powder of citrus peels were mixed separately in the containers with maize as 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 grams, respectively to 50 grams of the maize, and were shaken for 2 to 5 minutes to ensure homogeneous mixture. The intent test of unsexed 24-hour-old TKSNO adults from the culture were introduced into the container and covered with mesh net, and then an untreated, and we have the grape, the lemon, the lime, the sweet orange, and the tangerine. The results that showed that sweet orange peels and tangerine at 4, 5, and 6 grams gave highest mortality compared with the others. And there was no mortality recorded where there was no introduction or application of the powder. That is the control. Now in Figure 2 shows the concentration peels on number of feeding or exit rules. Equally, orange peels at 5 and 6 grams, grape, lemon, lime at 5 and 6 grams give the lowest number of feeding rules, while untreated recorded about 25.2. Which is the mean number of feeding rules. The effects of different concentrations on number of adults that emerged. On treated record about 65 adults emergence, while the treated recorded less than 10, showing their efficacy on the TKSNO. Now this is the effects of different concentration on the insect productivity. Insect productivity, just like I said, was taken after 30 days of introduction. And it was determined by looking at the number of insects that were still alive upon the total number of insects introduced. And 100 determined the insect productivity and those that emerged that were still active. And from the results, control recorded 100% productivity. While when treatment was administered, discovered that there was reduction in productivity. with 4, 5, and 6 grams giving a better result. This is on weight loss.
Similar trend was
also observed here, where on treated, recorded about 45% weight loss, showing that if our gains are not projected, it could lead to reduction in weight. And reduction in weight is comes as a result of damage caused by this byproduct insect. A review of literature on the effect of botanicals showed that citrus peels are highly toxic to small green pests. Results done by Motosu 2014 confirmed the result of this study, and numerous research that citrus oils from lemon, grapefruits, lime, and then they were applied topically were toxic to Campylobacter maculatus and Cytophilus oryzae. The mortality caused by citrus peels powder in this study, the chief incident could be attributed to several chemical metabolites such as terpenes and hydrocarbons, which exhibit both toxic and repellent effects on the pest organism. Results showed that orange or sweet orange fruit peels powder was the most potent and dangerous, that is, omitted on the mortality of this tick extenum. This result agrees with other reports done by DeWitt and Baker 2010, who reported that orange peels oil are at high concentration of 750 milligrams per liter applied at 3 meals cost 100% mortality to Zarus subfasciatus after 4 days of application. The recommendation research should be conducted using the oil extracts also, because this work was done using the powder. And better scientific methods of extracting and processing the citrus peels should also be adopted. Citrus peels could be recommended for the management of small product insects such as tick extenum.
Knowledge Minds, University of Calabar,
NRI,
and the Coast University. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor. Any questions? Looks like people are getting weaker and weaker. Perhaps we should break for coffee right now, tea, and move the next presentation to just after tea. Is that workable? Can we break for 15 minutes and then that's Apollonia, I think she's
Apollonia?
Yeah.
Are you happy to speak after coffee? You sure?
Right. Okay. Alright, so let's have a quick there are three stations out there. So some people should go right at the end, then right in the middle, and then go on cover one station. So let's eat in 15 minutes time. That's 25 minutes, 25 past. And can we have the next set of presentations, those who are going to be presenting later on, who have not yet submitted, make sure that you submit your presentations to Tinashe, who is already there. Please. And then the posters, Emmanuel, where are you? Please organize the posters at the back. There are still some Mochara issues.
Thank you. applied increased dosages as low as application rate to care for the losses. There is also a misuse of cabaret 85%, which is a contact and stomach insecticide, which is normally used for the control of red boar, tiny boar, and the other cotton pests in Zimbabwe. And this in turn increases the risk of food poisoning. The growing demand for pesticide-free food is a call for the optimization of pesticide plants as well as other non-synthetic chemical options. The problem statement. Poppy production is low among smaller farmers due to have insect-facing processing at both pre and post stages. Despite the low yield, farmers incur further considerable damage due to storage insect pests. Synthetic pesticides are in use and are associated with 1. Ineffectiveness against poppy breeding, 2. Risk of food poisoning, as well as negative effects to organisms as well as the environment and users. And the objectives were, the main objective was to evaluate the effectiveness of different storage options against storage pests, and the specific objectives were to determine the effectiveness of different pesticide plants against poppy storage insect pests. And the other one was to determine the effect of different poppy storage options on seed germinability that was done after 18 months of storage. Moving on to methodology, the investigation to determine the efficacy of different pesticide plants versus commercial synthetic pesticides were carried out under contrasting agro-climatic conditions, that is in weather and Gire, weather falling under Natural Region 3 and Gire falling under Natural Region 5. And this is the third map showing the two areas. Gire as the part of this is the map of Zimbabwe. Then Gire as the northern part of the country where the temperature ranges between 32 to 42 degrees Celsius and the relative humidity is ranges between 37 to 55%. Also whether the other side which is warm and cooler, which is at the middle part of the country, which where the low temperatures of around 28 to 32 degrees Celsius and relative humidity of 55 to 75, which is relatively higher. The insecticide of plants evaluated were Acacia remiana, that is in Mungalishona, it is in Korokana, and Calophosphema mucani, where Acacia remiana and Innocent Corocana were used in weather only, and Calophosphema mucani were used in Gire due to cultural beliefs and practices. Then the samples weighing 500 grams were collected every 8 weeks over a period of 10 months, and the parameters measured were insect grain damage, total number of insects, that is alive and dead, as well as the grain weight loss. And here the participatory method was used as an extension method where the farmers were involved in setting up of the experiment as well as visual assessment of the grain. Here the laboratory tests were conducted to determine the germinability of the grain, that is after the 10 months of storage. And this is the table showing exactly what I've been saying. The unregistered organic pesticides which were used, that is, it is in Korokana, Acacia remiana, which were used in weather only, and they were used according to farmer specifications. That is, it was in a 2.5
Around
below 5%, and for the other treatment, it was beyond 20%. Then for Pombire, we can see that even to actually go, it managed to suppress the drain weight loss was low before 24 weeks, and thereafter it dried. It dried. Then for Timokani, generally it was low, but there were no significant differences among the treatments. But among the botanical pesticides, generally it managed to have. Moving on to the germination test results, which was done after 10 months. Until it goes, it managed to have 100% germination, but among the botanical pesticides, Calophosoma mucani recorded the highest germination with 51%. And the lab experiment, which was done to support the main research, showed that chemocardi can be used. As you can see, that a rate of 1% weight managed to suppress images of Calophosoma rhodesianus, and there was no significant differences between the commercially available synthetic pesticide as well as chemocardi. And you can also see that even the rate of 1%, 0.5, and 0.1% also fell in the same range, and there were no significant differences. Then the summary of results. General safety built up across sites was higher in the compared to urine. Then among the best heads of plants, chemocardi was the most effective, especially during the first 24 weeks. Then the rate of 1.5% for chemocardi was equally effective to commercially synthetic pesticides. And also there were variations which were noted among the commercially available synthetics, where actually got suppressed the build-up, but Tumba Super Grass did not. Then the actually got managed to lessen the intermediate weight loss, but the other commercially synthetic pesticides did not. Then, moving on to the conclusions and recommendations. Here the laboratory tests on the promising pesticide of plants, like chemocardi fresh leaves, to determine chemical composition and mode of action. And also, there is a need for extraction and evaluation of different active compounds in chemocardi. And the last one, here the uniform tests in different agroecological regions to determine if the recommendation to specific sites or across all cowpea growing areas. As you can see that due to cultural beliefs in the areas, only chemocardi was used in Mire and the other one. Hence we need to do uniform tests across the sites. Acknowledgement. I'd like to acknowledge the EU and the FAO for funding the research, as well as the University of Zimbabwe, Faculty of Public Health, for technical assistance.
Work in this group, Chemical Ecology and In Vitro Biology, where we are specialists in the analysis, isolation, and structure and elucidation of plant compounds. And we are interested in their bioassay for biological activity testing against pest control and compounds that occur in fungi and mediate interactions between plants and insects. So the plant species I'm talking about is Marua aegivus. Came to my knowledge through Brighton and colleagues here in Zimbabwe. It's actually found across Africa, but here are the locations where it's distributed in Zimbabwe. It's a small tree, grows to about 3 meters. And the reason I became interested in it was because Brighton and his colleagues found that it was biologically active, at least the plant materials were, against certain arthropods that were important in Zimbabwe. And this is some bioactivity data from Brighton showing activity of extracts from the river Aegivus against a tick of, I can't remember which species it was, I think it's Boophilus, was it Boophilus? dwarf of the species, and comparing that to tick buster, which is the industry standard for controlling ticks, and you can see that as you increase the concentration of Borrelia extracts, you actually get up to quite similar effects as you're getting with the tick buster. Interesting point that Elof made yesterday about using solvent controls. You can see here that comparing distilled water to methanol, which is what these were extracted in, that the methanol has a biological activity against the ticks. So what Kovas was saying was correct. We need to be mindful of the solvents we're using, just a little less than that. Brighton also found that there was very potent activity of the plant material against Callus abrucus, this time Rhodesiarus in cowpeas. So I chose to look at the chemistry to find out what the chemicals were that might mediate these effects in a test on our species of Callus abrucus macularis. That's the one we have in culture in the UK. So the first thing to do was to make extracts of a limited amount of plant material. And analyze the material. Could you see that? That's fairly clear, isn't it? Yeah, it looks fairly unclear on my computer. That's good. So I was quite surprised at how little there was in there. I was a bit disappointed, actually. I thought I might have been duped. But there were these two, three minor peaks here, one big peak here, a couple of other little things, something at the beginning. You always get something at the beginning. I didn't really take much notice of it. But we did actually spend time isolating these four compounds. They had UV spectra that were fairly familiar to me, representative of compounds called phenylpropanoids. Cutting a very long story short, that involved a lot of isolation, a lot of structural elucidation using NMR, we found out that those four compounds were rather unusual natural products to find in a plant. They were these amide derivatives of what is effectively a decarboxylated arginine called agmatine, or aminobutylguanidine, and this phenylpropanoid, which is actually the hydroxycinnamoyl, or called coumaroyl, or coumaric acid. It's very common in plants. And you often find it esterified to lots of other compounds, often to flavonoids, sort of glycosidic parts of flavonoids, to saponins. We don't really know what ecological role this plays, but we do find it very commonly in plants esterified to things, or in this case, through an amide bond attached to this, what would appear to be a fairly harmless derivative of an amino acid. So we found four compounds, they were all closely related. Essentially, there are two groups, one that has a hydroxy group here, and the Z and E cinnamoyl for aminobutylguanidine that doesn't. So it's basically a bald benzene ring here. And these compounds occurred at these amounts. These are all fairly accurate relative representations of the quantities. So the most abundant was this compound here, the E cinnamoyl 4-aminobutylguanidine. Basically, it's this compound without hydroxy, and this is bent upwards. So these are our four compounds. Okay. Now, the problem was for bioassays, we didn't have very much material. So we could only isolate small quantities, probably not enough. So we looked at the possibility of synthesizing them. It looked like a fairly simple molecule through a simple amide bond. You could actually buy this part of it, agmatine, off the shelf, and you could also buy this part of it. So we combined agmatine sulfate with sodium carbonate, for a minute with cinnamoyl chloride, and filtered the precipitate, washed with cold water, and then dried, and hey presto. We were able to produce the E4s of both the 4-hydroxy and the cinnamoyl. The trouble is we couldn't produce the E4s through this process, so we had to do that with UV irradiation. We talked about UV unstable compounds. Well, when you've got phenylpropanoids, they naturally occur more often as the E4 rather, which is the cis. Sorry, the trans, I'm getting myself all muddled here. So this is the trans, which is essentially the E4, and this is how they occur typically naturally. But we wanted the Z4, which is the cis, and so we had to stick it in UV light for about three days, and then you get kind of a balance between the two. An interesting kind of isomerization going on there. There was a fifth compound that we found that was actually occupying the beginning of the chromatogram here, a compound called saccharin. Also interestingly, a derivative of another amino acid called proline. So if you take these two methyls off, you've got proline, so it's essentially methane proline with these two methyls attached to this nitrogen. Luckily, this is quite a common compound found in lots of plant materials and is available off the shelf, so we didn't have to try and synthesize this. It's got medicinal properties in traditional Chinese medicine, so arguably fairly safe to consume as well. So we found these compounds actually at very high concentrations in the leaf. There wasn't really anything else, not very much in the way of flavonoids and so on, which you would typically expect to find. And we quantified the amounts that we found and used these as a way of trying to test the compounds in bioassays. I'm not going to go into the details of them, but actually 20,000 micrograms per gram, or 20 mg per gram, is very large quantities. We're talking like 2% by weight. There's a large amount of this stachydrin in the plant material. Again, ecologically, we don't know why it's there. It'd be interesting to find out. In terms of answering Brian's question, I think we do have the answer. Essentially, the four compounds that you just saw on the list are here, Q1374 through 77. Here's the control, untreated or just treated with the solvent. And here is the Marua extract, and here's our positive control, rotenone and stachydrin mix. We had a mix because we've also got a 5-hydroxy in there, which we couldn't separate very easily. And this just shows after 3 days and 6 days, mortality of Marua edulis compounds and plant material against Bruchids. And you can see that, actually compared to rotenone, they're quite slow acting, these compounds, but eventually after about 6 days, they do finally catch up. So these compounds could explain the mortality that Brighton was finding with his plant materials. In a little bit more detail, you can see here we've tested the plant extract at different concentrations, and then we've tested the individual compounds at equivalent concentrations as they would be found in here. So this is compound 1, the Z-cumaroyl-agmatine 2, the E-cumaroyl-agmatine, etc., etc. Actually, we find that probably the most important compound for explaining the biological activity, the mortality here, is actually the E-cinnamoyl-agmatine, which was the compound that I think eluted last. Might have to check that before and afterwards. And you can see here, stachydrin also has quite a lot of biological activity when tested at equivalent concentrations as they would occur in these different tests of the Marua plant material. None of them are as effective as the rotenone positive control, except the compounds in Marua that correspond. These bars that correspond to E-cinnamoyl agmatine. Anyway, these compounds do appear to explain the biological activity that Brighton was getting. We also have data showing, I'm not going to go into too much detail because we're very short of time, that shows that these compounds, at least the cinnamoyl compounds, also explain some anti-overposition activity, which we find in the original plant material, that are less well explained by the cumaroyl agmatines. So we find a little bit more detail about these compounds, but certainly these compounds are biologically active and probably explain Brighton's original test. So very quickly, conclusions. Methanol extracts are toxic to maculatus, even as low as 0.1%, so it's quite possible this could be a useful material at low concentration applications. Secondary metabolite chemistry is fairly unusual, comprising these odd amino acid derivatives, one of them the agmatine being substituted with these phenylpropanoids. All the compounds show some biological activity against our Bruchids, but the cinnamoyl derivatives appear to be the most biologically active. And these derivatives can be synthesized fairly easily, and so there's a possibility, I guess, that this could be a clue as to potential synthetic or semi-synthetic product derived from a plant material. So hopefully we've saved a few minutes there. Thank you very much to other people who have revolved the work that weren't in the author list, and thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Bill, for saving time, the presentation itself. I think we have time for two questions.
I wanted to ask if this compound, the cinnamoyl compounds, are related to compounds found in cinnamon?
No, so probably originally cinnamic acid So cinnamic acid is the bald version of this. So if you take that hydroxy group, just have a bald benzene ring, and you come down here, instead of this amide bond, you have a hydroxy, which dehydrates to form this amide. So if you just have that with a hydroxy group there and nothing on there, that's a compound called cinnamic acid. It's very abundant, almost ubiquitous in plants. And then if you have this compound with a hydroxy, it's cumaric acid, which is also very ubiquitous. The cinnamic acid was probably, yes, originally found in cinnamomum. But whether or not these agmatine derivatives are there or not, I suspect not. I mean, I've never come across them. They seem quite an unusual derivative to me. But so I don't know about the origins of them.
Thank you, Phil. Well, I was wondering, did you check for any glucosinolates? Because it's caprase, so it should contain glucosinolates as well.
No, we didn't. But we did look at the methanol extract, and although I haven't shown you right to the like 30 minutes when it finishes, there's really nothing else eluting.
But probably you lost everything.
Well, that's a possibility. So they may have had some biological activity, but remember we did isolate, or rather synthesize, these compounds, and they were biologically active. And they are equivalent in biological activity to the original extract. So I would expect these to really be explaining the biological activity. But you're right, there may be glucosinolates there too, as you say, it's caprases. So.
Okay, thank you once again. It's very interesting that, as you say, there's always a peak at the start of the chromatogram. And we always did it. I will learn something from you. It's good to look at it.
Yeah, have a look.
Yeah.
Okay, then we find something. You get a lot of very polar alkaloids actually eluting at the beginning, and they can be quite badly obscured, especially in LCMS when you've got a lot of other stuff in fairly polar extracts coming off all the kind of amino acids and. So yes, it's worth trying to tease that apart. Maybe reducing the organic solvent that you start with, maybe starting with 5 or even 3% organic, so you can kind of maybe pull out some of the compounds in the beginning.
Okay. I'm still surprised that you have got so many. I mean, it's so few compounds from a plant. Was your extraction method correct?
The extraction method is fairly simple. Apart from acetone, which Professor Eloff attests to being the best, methanol is probably the second best. So it was just a methanol extract which extracts everything from amino acids right through to fatty acids. Not necessarily comprehensively in terms of the total quantities, but yes, it's the solvent that basically extracts everything. So there really isn't much else there. Which is unusual.
Right. Yeah, it's very, very unusual. I would perhaps prefer extracting the whole lot and look at the range of chemicals, perhaps chloroform one-to-one with methanol, so that you get more compounds rather than just using one solvent.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, thank you. Phil? Another round.
Paul, can you come up?
I'll have to say in a couple of minutes. I'll reach you. Okay, is this working? Right, okay, brilliant. Right, first I'd like to say thank you to the organisers for organising the conference so well. And giving me the opportunity to speak. So what I'm going to tell you about today is kind of dovetails a little bit with Phil's talk that he just gave, because I'm explaining a little bit more about the bioisosis we do when we actually test some of these extracts against the group of species that we've got at Kew Gardens. Is it the arrow right and left or?
Arrow right, yeah.
Okay. Previous speakers have saved me a bit of time, so perhaps we might be able to get some more, catch up some more time. Benonia and Siphonia. They're weed species, they're invasive, but they're easily grown and they have insecticidal activity, which are the main foci for this presentation. Unfortunately, I don't have a picture of Tithonia in flower, but if you look at your, there's a very good picture of the Tithonia showing the very beautiful flowers on there in the pesticide plants book. Okay, so many previous speakers have alluded to the problem of Glossa brutus in cowpea. I just wanted to highlight here the fact that our Ghanaian strain of Brucius of Cabecue love cowpea. There's a kind of lean casserole in the background, and if you're maybe able to see the eggs laid, this has had 10 generations of Brucius on it, and they actively select the cowpea. So they are very, 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 very fond of cowpea as an open position site. I just let you read this because many of the previous speakers have carried, given a much more detailed overview of cowpea and its importance. So I'll scan over that slide. But an answer to the problem of rootlets on cowpea is to admix plant materials. One alternative is to use it in the field as an extract to spray onto plants. So this talk is kind of bridging the gap between what's going on in the field. There are field trials going on with beans. We're using Bononia and Tithonia extracts. Here we're using equivalent extract concentrations, so 100 milligrams per mil of dried plant material in pyrisase. So we're equating the methanolic extracts that we're preparing in the lab to what the farmers are actually finding and applying. Field, although the solvent system is different. This is the equipment that we're using for analysing fruit extracts. If anyone wants to go into detail about what this actually does, then I can talk to you afterwards. It's basically an HPLC to separate the compounds, which are then injected onto a mass spectrometer, which gives you an accurate mass of the compounds. And then you can compare those accurate masses with compounds that are already known from Bononia and Tithonia, and from that you can start to build up a picture of what is in the extracts. Allied to that is the fact that you can also do MS to the N, which is repeatedly ionized molecules, and it gives you some idea of how they fragment and what's attached to the main parent molecule. So this is the crude methanol extracts of Tithonia on the left, and Bononia on the right. The only thing I want you really to take from this is that the Bononia has a much more rich composition of different compounds. The Tithonia only has a few, although possibly there's some coagulation going on with some of them. You see the figures at the top, they are the molecular, the mass to charge ratio of the ions that are produced in the mass spectrometer. The one that's informative in the left hand is the one, the middle one, which is the M plus H of an isolate, a compound that's subsequently isolated. But the main point I want to get from that is that there are a lot more compounds with higher molecular weights. So you can see 17.36. If you can see it like that, there's a molecular weight of 1308. So they're much larger molecules. Right. Ah, yes. So 1308 here. Much higher molecular weight compounds here. Then we went on to fractionate. As the chemistry of these plants is so well known, we attempted to do a crude fractionation and attempted an isolation as well to look at the effects of the different polarities of compounds within the extracts. This is a system HPLC, and at the end of the photodiodorate detector here, there's a little tube which sticks out, and I sit there for periods of time collecting the samples as they come up. And this is what we got from the crude fractionation of Tithonia. The first one is actually a pure compound which is subsequently identified by NMR, and that's tegetinin A, which is a sesquiterpene. And then you'll see that there is a rough difference in polarity towards the end of the extract, where you're getting kind of the dregs that are coming off at the end of the fractionation. This is Vinonia mixolina. Once again, it's got these compounds of kind of low polarity, medium polarity, and then these higher molecular weight compounds to this side. So this is some examples of what they are. This is a sesquiterpene there. We've got some more sesquiterpenes. There's a tetrahydroxyflavone, tagetanin there, tagetanin B. Tisbidulin, which is another flavone. Zidonimide, which is quite an unusual ceramide compound with a fatty acid attached to a nitrogen. And then we've got some compounds which it was possible to differentiate. So we've got some which could be diversifol or tagetanin H. One thing about the chemistry of these two compounds is that two plants is that they're producing such a diverse range of compounds but with similar structures that they're people are running out of imagination and they're calling them tagetanin H, I, etc. So they've got very similar. When they started producing the compound, they kind of stuck with it and just modified the structure slightly. Then these are sesquiterpene lactones in Vinonia mixolina. And then we've got these interesting compounds, which are the same steroidal saponins, which are the high molecular weight compounds that we're looking at in those early chromatograms. So this is the bioassay that we use. So Daynor had an extract and evaporated a sample onto there. Day three had the cowpea seeds. Now this is to kind of simulate if you've got some insecticidal barrier between the insects and the seeds. So you expose them to an insecticidal barrier. Some get through maybe, they get to the seeds and then maybe they lay eggs. It provides a kind of refuge, and then after 6 days we assess mortality again to see if there's any latent toxicity for the stimulation of the insects getting through the insecticidal barrier. So this is the results of the mortality. Along the bottom here we have I wanted to get it onto one side. So we've got Tithonia at 10, 1, and 0.1, Vinonia at 10, 1, and 0.1% equivalence. Then tagetanin, the fractions are going across here to Vinonia, and then Vinonia starts here. We have a rotenone control and a mag control, sorbent control. What I want you to pick out from here is that the control shows very low mortality. Everything causes mortality in the fractions. If we look at the rotenone control, many of them are as effective as the rotenone control. And bear in mind, these are fractions of an extract, often at very low concentrations. Then if we move to some of them, inexplicable lowered mortality, that requires more investigation. I'm not quite sure of the cause of that at the moment. Maybe that actually acts as a repellent, so they don't. There's a lot of probing behavior from the females onto the dried extract. You can see the spheres in the extract. Maybe they're slightly more repelled from probing. Exhibiting overposition behavior, so therefore they're not exposed to such a degree of toxicity. And then we've got this one here, which is at a very low concentration, 3.56 parts per million. So it could be a concentration effect which is causing that. So then we move on to overposition. Once again, we have the control, so overposition is relatively high. We move on to the rotenone control, and overposition is, this is the 1,000 parts per million, which is surprising actually that it wasn't the rotenone 100 parts per million, was more overposition suppressant. If you look here from the 100 parts per million, so some of these things are inexplicable, and as I say, it couldn't be due to the behavior of the insect in response to the extract on the vial or the sample on the vial. So some key findings from this, crude extracts and fractions are as toxic to C. maculatus as the whole extract when presented at representative concentrations, which I think is quite interesting. The suppression of the overposition is much less consistent, but there is still some effect. And the activity spans a range of compounds, although the nanoemulsifier seems to have the ability to produce much more complex high molecular weight molecules. Some suggested practical implications. You could, because there's such a variety of there's such a difference in the polarity of some of the compounds, you could actually extract twice and apply them as a sequential treatment, which is one thing you could do. And one of the important things which I came up with, I was getting quite prosaic last night as I was editing some of this, is that if you can link pesticidal plant cultivation with biological activity and chemical profiling, that could be the way forward if we can combine all our resources together. Thank you for listening. And I'd just like to thank the funders, EU Options, McKnight, DAT, Dr. Rene Greyer, who's a colleague at Kew, who's got an encyclopedic brain for looking at UV spectra and can identify just about anything that has a UV spectra. And thank you once again.
Thank you very much. Two questions.
Thanks for your interesting presentation. I would know if Bernonia or Bernonia are grown, are cultivated in Africa, or are they wild resources?
I don't believe that they're cultivated, because they're invasive. I'm not sure of the exact situation. Someone else might know more about them.
Another question is if Bernonia is used for other uses, as poison or something like this.
They've got medicinal uses and of course it's other uses, anti-cancer, anti-microbial, so.
Bernonia is also, Bernonia anchomycaline is also known as a bitter leaf, which is actually a popular vegetable in West Africa. I'm sure there are some West Africans here who know it quite well, so it's eaten quite a lot. It's not really cultivated as far as I understand. Tilonia diversifolia is an invasive weed from the Americas, and actually it's illegal to plant it in South Africa. So it's considered an invasive weed. So this actually might be a way of controlling its invasiveness by gathering it up. It really takes over water courses.
Once again, thank you, Paul. Now, we call upon I think I'm done for my session. Then you will move you up, so you can come. Yeah. So let me just finish up.
Ladies and gentlemen, I know it's close to lunchtime, so whatever Henry VIII said to one of his wives, I won't keep you long. I don't see you, just throw me with a bottle, and it's maybe 5 minutes to go. Get the thing going. Where are I cooking in there? Come on down. Okay, I've changed my presentation somewhat after some of the discussions I've heard today. So I'm going to talk about plants and animals against fungal pathogens. I'm going to discuss different methods and approaches that we use that I think could be of value to some people working in the related field. Then I'll show you the results we got with random screening of more than 703 species, examples of success that we have in food spoilage, poultry production, and plant protection against pathogens. So in the developed world, the major problem is the development of resistance against microorganisms. Many authors say that we are reaching entering the post-antibiotic era. You hear about the multiple resistant mycobacteriums against TB, which is a really bad problem. And just look at this, no level antibiotic structure has been discovered in the last 30 years. If you look at beta-amphotericin, the compound, the vast double structure that has been used to formulate a series of antimicrobials, that was discovered in 1956. And I think many of these aspects also relate to pesticidal plants. Hormonal development in the developing world is, as you see all those things, I'm not going to read it. And what we really wanted to do, we want to use our science to solve the problem of the poor people, especially with the resources that they have available. Okay, the problem is, what do we do? How do we identify plants that have not been used traditionally? The work that we do on parasites, the only measure we really have is traditional use. But I'm going to tell you, our ideas developed to have a totally different approach. If we look at the methods that have been used to determine antimicrobial activity, the agar diffusion method is a relatively nice and simple method. You put a little bit or a plug of the compound that you want to test on a field of bacteria, and then you measure the inhibition area of inhibition. So the point is, the higher the activity is at a given concentration, the further it will diffuse and it will, at that stage, detect it. But agar diffusion does not work well with plant extracts. The reason is mainly because if there are compounds that are non-polar, they will not diffuse in the aqueous agar matrix. And this is the time I evaluated some results of an author that did it both of these. Look at that. You expect the correlation coefficient to be in the order of 0.9, this was 0.05. Therefore, for plant extracts, agar diffusion does not work. It's a relatively simple system. For individual compounds, it works. For a one compound, you've got the compound and you can set up a graph of concentration and result, then it can work. So the method used by the majority of researchers up until about 10 years ago was agar diffusion. Nowadays, good journals will not publish agar diffusion results for antimicrobials for a plant extract. You can, if you really have very difficult, you can have an agar dilution method. What you do there, you've got the agar plates and you've got different concentrations of your compound or your extract in the plates, and then you can stick some microorganism there and see where the microorganism grows. But this is much less active than other methods. So I developed this method assay for determining plant extracts. Very simple, you make a serial dilution and then you add a compound, like rhizolium violet, and where the bacteria or the fungi, it works very well in both cases, are active, it turns purple. So this thing has now been cited about 1,400 times, and it's used very, very widely. There's another problem that is in the whole process. Traditional units use mainly cocktail infusion of water. And there's also a few other things as well, but mainly it's water. Now look at the results that we have here. One plant we worked with, Comerica microphyllum, if you look on the left-hand side, we evaluated a whole series of extractants that was on the left-hand side. Isopropyl ether, ethyl ether, methane nitrobite, etc., water right-hand side. And if you look at this side, this was the activity, this is equivalent to the activity of the plant. In this side, you see there was no activity in the water extract. If you look what is extracted, that's the water. There's very little, few things that come out in water from this plant. And the same thing happens in many other plants. So that made us consider using acetone. Acetone was the one with the highest activity. You'll see, I'll provide some more results at a later stage. This is what we found with another plant, Comerica woodyi. Again, there's very little activity with the water and the XM extract. And what we do here, this is an extremely powerful method. You separate the compounds on a TLC, and then you spray the TLC plate with the fungus or the bacteria that you want to use. And then in this case, you can see X-ray didn't extract that compound, the water didn't extract it. There was hardly anything coming out of the water with this plant. And so you can see in this case there's only one compound, there's a few minor compounds up there, but there was only one compound that had good activity. And this is really extremely handy because now when you want to isolate the compound, you can search for a compound with that R value without having too many assays. And this was the compound. We were very excited about this compound because what was very interesting, this was one of the first compounds that had extremely good antibacterial activity, and it also had very good antioxidant activity. And there was a major problem some time ago of replacing antibiotic feed additives in poultry production. So we ran an animal experiment with this, and that's the active compound that we isolated from there. And unfortunately, it didn't work very well because the poultry lost weight, they didn't gain weight. So it was toxic to the animals. And we can use it as a weight reducing agent. If we look at the results of other authors, many authors have found more or less the same thing. So the conclusion is water extracts have a very limited antimicrobial activity. There are some cases where it's different. If the compounds are tannins, then it may be soluble in water and it could come out. So the implications of what we found is that the assay used is questionable, water is only available extracted to rural traditional healers, then traditional ethnomedicinal leaf may not be useful. So people investigated the wrong plants, they used the wrong techniques, and so we thought it's a good idea, let's go and look at more plants. But less than 10% of the 250,000 plant species have even been partly investigated. Our hypothesis was if you do random screening, it may yield highly active extract. But the difficulties in random screening, even in South Africa, we've got 24,000 species. Plant collection is difficult, it's expensive. Plant identification requires expertise. Selection and extraction is also another problem. So our approach was, we investigated only trees and only looked at leaves of trees for sustainable use reasons. We collected material only in good botanical grasses. We ensured proper drying, grinding and storage. We used only one extractant. And we used a number of students to do the assays. Each assay was done in triplicate. And also another very important thing is you must use the correct microorganisms. Correct is a difficult term, but these four that we used, the ACTT strains are the organisms used internationally to compare different antibiotics. Staph aureus, Enterococcus fecalis, E. coli, Cervonis aeruginosa. And we also had a look at methicillin resistant Staph aureus, Mycobacterium smicmatis. Mycobacterium smicmatis is the safe mycobacterium organism to use, and we added a look at two fungi, Cryptococcus and Candida. So we investigated 735 tree species. The main aim was to find out, is there a taxonomic relationship? Could we identify orders or families or genera with very high activity so that we can focus in on that? We had quite a nice publication, I think, in which we investigated different orders. But what actually came out of it afterwards is tremendous, because now we identified, and the idea was if you have a plant extract with good activity against one of the fungi that we investigated, there's a reasonable chance it may be active against other fungi as well. So the first thing we started, we looked at the number of plants that had very high activity against fungi. Fungal diseases cause enormous problems to plants, not only to plants. One fungus, Phytophthora infestans, led to the death of 1 million people in Ireland. It led to 1 million people emigrating for Ireland. It led to a reduction of about 25% of the number of people in Ireland. That's just one fungus. Many other fungi cause tremendous, enormous problems with production. But it's not only the loss of productivity, it's also toxins. Mycotoxins cause enormous problems. So there are many cases where fungi plays a very important role. The first example is we have a look at the transportation of food, for example. Citrus is one of the major products South Africa is transported all over the world, and if there's an infection during the movement of the citrus, it could lead to a collapse of the whole shipment. So we investigated a number of plants that had good activity against other fungi from our database, and we found some of them, here some of those plants, the ones that are in colored are ones with very good activity. So you can see that some of the plants had really good activity. We investigated, I think it's about 9 different phytopathogens. So we selected the best one. And then what came out as a tremendous figure in this case, we developed another procedure. If you have 5 plants that you examine, and you want to determine which one of those 5 plants is the one that will be the best to use, we developed the concept of total activity. In other words, I do not only look at what the MIC is in milligram per milliliter of the extract, I also take into account the quantity that I extracted with my extractant. So a large quantity was extracted from Grenadia, and Grenadia had a very good activity, and it gave the value of 17,000 milliliters per gram. What does that mean? That means if you take the extract from 1 gram and you dilute it to 17,000 milliliters, it will still kill the fungus, theoretically. So this is a very useful parameter if you want to compare the different plants. And it has the same activity against penicillium, and penicillium is one of the causative agents. This is the plant, and that's the active compound that we isolated. And then when my wife bought some oranges, one of the oranges got rotten, we isolated the compound, it was a penicillium, and then we did a nice little experiment. We used the one fruit differentiations divided into 6 parts, and one was a positive control, other was a negative control, and then 4 different concentrations of extract, and then in each case we inoculated it with the fungus. So from that we could get some quite nice results. This is what it looks like within a day or 2. You can see different sides, you measure the diameter there, and after a short period it looks like that total mess. Unfortunately, what we always do in all these cases, we also look at the cytotoxicity. And the cytotoxicity of this thing was really very, high cytotoxicity, with the result that that should actually be selectivity index. The selectivity index was very low. What that actually means, it's more toxic to human cells than it is to the fungus, so that just killed that one. Safety could be a major concern here. Then the next thing we did, we had a look at treating animals against fungal infections of Aspergillus fumigatus. Aspergillosis is a very important disease in poultry production. It is also something that humans sometimes get when they, because parrots get the disease and they can infect, and it's a disease that infects your lungs. So, again, we found, after looking at a number of plants, we found this one plant, Oxystylus, at relatively good activity. We isolate the main compound, again, it had triterpenoid, Lupeol in this case. We did an experiment with some poultry. I'm not going to bore you with the details, but the important thing is we could show that up to a concentration of 200 milligrams per milliliter, there was no signs of toxicity. Toxicity is not only looking to see whether the poultry looks good, you also have to sacrifice them and look at the number of enzymes and anything. So the active compound, ketoconazole, can only use up to a concentration of 60 milligrams per kilogram. Up to 200 milligrams per kilogram of our plant extract, just the crude acid and plant extract, looked well. So then we infected the poultry and had different treatments. We evaluated the efficacy looking by chemical and hematological parameters, also the number of fungi in the lungs, the growth of the animals. And the very important first thing is, because what you do, you take an active extract and then you inoculate into the eyes of the chicks. And then you have to make sure that there was presence in the lung. You can see all these, I can't see it, but one of you may be anatomist. tell me that you can see that the yeast infection was disappeared. And this is, the stress experiment works very nicely. We were scared of repeating it. Because what we have here, this is different concept of the pathological scoring. The pathologist in a blinded study that didn't know what was which treatment was which treatment. If you look at this, this is the tetraconazole, this is our positive control. And if you look at different contexts, there's a statistical significant difference between tetraconazole and between our 1200 milligram per kilogram extracted. Look at this beautiful dose-related response. And this was the untreated control, it was infected and it was not treated. So I think that is very convincing results. If we also look at the number of fungi found in the lungs, the same type of thing, that one was a neutral one that wasn't infected. We wanted to see whether infection could be carried from some animals to the others. So beautiful relationship again like that. So even just crude acetone leaf extracted this thing, I want to think to make that. And the tree grows relatively well all over South Africa. But that is one of the big problems that we find, before I go to this one. We get to things like this, and we don't have the expertise, we don't have the knowledge to get to companies that could potentially market and develop. And I think the last one I want to discuss here is activity against the plant fungal pathogens using Melianthus scabrosus. Melianthus scabrosus is a weed growing very widely all over South Africa. The Afrikaans name is Krakiroermanie, it means shrub, don't touch me. Because if you touch it, it gives off a bad smell. It gives a bad smell because it stops animals grazing it. It's got a pungent flavor, so we have to look at the leaves. It actually came to us in a very surprising way. A company wanted us to do some research, and the literature is known that this thing is used as a topical product. They use extracts of Melianthus to protect skin against bacterial infections. When we had a look at the bacterial activity, it had very low activity. We told the guy it's not useful. Then we decided just to have a look at the antifungal activity. The antifungal activity was very, very good. So we isolated the antifungal compounds, and there you can see again the same type of thing as everywhere. The water extract, very little coming out. That's a purpose, not complete cases in many other cases. So, and then we have investigated these different pathogens. These pathogens were selected, the most important fungal pathogens by our Department of Plant Production. Now this is, I think, a very important graph. If you ever want to talk or have an argument with me about acetone, look at this one. If you look at the extraction yield of the acetone, acetone for this plant had a relatively low extraction yield. Look at the extraction yield of methanol. The methanol extract is up to 20% acetone. And here I've got, this is the inverse of MIC. Because I'd like to show if it's a high activity, that means 1 milligram of acetone extract can be diluted to 10 milliliters and it will still be active. So acetone extracted a smaller quantity and even this, and it had a much higher activity. If you look at the next one, by comparing the percentage extracted in antibacterial, acetone had 52 times higher activity than the methyl extract on the mass base. I've been wondering why this happened. I think what happens is that acetone is relatively strong on the intermediate polarity compounds as well. And maybe these are the compounds that are bioavailable to the pathogens and maybe to humans as well. So that may be an explanation. If it's too polar, it may not be entered the system easily. So acetone got very good results. Here again, in this case again, we isolated the compound there. Again, biotography shows you that compound that inhibited the pathogen, this case penicillin expansum. The compound is isolated. It had reasonable activity. The pure compound itself, this case was that of the nomic acid. But, yeah, so we got something that looks very good. then what we then started doing by solvent-solvent fractionation, we said, could we increase the activity of our acetone extract? And in fact, we could extract, and we had two. And the reason for doing that, if you want to patent only that the plant extracts got very high activity, it's not a very strong patent. But if you can patent the development of an extract from the plant, it's much stronger. Now, we developed the products H2O2, and now this is our results. This is H2O2, our product. The higher the value is, the more activity. These are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 commercially used fungicides. It beat all these 6 like crazy. There's no comparison. They have the same activity as copper oxychloride. Copper oxychloride, unfortunately, is environmentally very toxic. It's also very important if you spray your plants with a product that, and it starts raining after a while, that the rain shouldn't wash it off the plant. So the water solubility is relatively important. And we found that the water solubility was less than 1 milligram per liter. Even if we acidify, basify it, ethanol is about 1, ethyl acetate 400, and acetone more than 1,000 milligrams per milliliter. Now, all of this is good and nice. It looks good if you do the in vitro work. But then we had someone came to us and said they grew comfrey in the field. The comfrey was infected with a fungus that really causes major problems. So we sprayed it with our product, sprayed it 2 times, day 1 and day 17. And this is Brava, the commercial product, and this is the control that was not sprayed. So after 50 days out, our product gave 50 infected leads, Brava gave 250, and with the control that was not sprayed, it was just a total mess. So it looks as if this thing really has a very important role to play. Then we asked another question. The activity, where does it come? Is it the plant itself, or it could be endophytes present within the plant that does that? So we isolated about 25 endophytes. We determined the activity of the different endophytes. This is 30 against, we tested against 10 different of these pathogenic fungi. And 2 of these had activity, good activity. If I say good activity, I mean activity more than 0.1 milligram per milliliter against 8 of the 10. So, I think there's a reasonable good chance that the endophytes could be responsible for the activity. It's not clear. There's a lot of discussion going on about that. We're in the process of identifying the endophytes. It is potentially possible to see, to have a fermenter so you can grow the endophytes specially, and that could become an industrial process. It is probably not only a linoleic acid, because it's only one compound. I don't think there's too much hope for it. Another very important thing, if you want to register a product, you have to look at the environmental safety. So we did a number of assays on earthworms. We made mixtures of between 40 is the activity of the extract, going up to 250. And we had this system, we mix it with soil and then with different concentrations. And after 7 to 14 days, also another system where we just put the extract on filter paper, there was no sign of any loss of viability in any of these cases. So the product may be environmentally safe. Another question to ask is how stable is the product? So here we kept it at 55 degrees for 30 days, kept it in light and dark, and if you look at those figures, they were 0.08, 0.08, there was no change in the biological activity. There may have been changes in chemical composition, but in biological activity, there was no changes. So the overall conclusion is that some plants not express and sufficiently antifungal activity to use, and they control certain fungi to the same degree as commercial products. So it was worthy of increasing the activity or decreasing toxicity by using solvent-solvent fractionation, something I think we should all look at very carefully. So the take-home message is possible to develop a useful patentable product from plant extracts. Our biggest weapon is our database of 735 plant extracts evaluated against these, I think it's 10 different microorganisms. So some of the things we use in those cases, there's also something else that we found out recently. We did a lot of work on antiparasitic activity, but the assay is complicated. Haemonctus is a nematode that causes enormous problems in sheep production especially. But then we got the idea that, well, one of the antifungals, of the antihelminths is also known to have good antifungal activity. So then we started comparing antifungal activity and antihelminthic activity. And of course it won't be true in all cases, but if the same target is targeted by the antifungal compound and the antihelminthic compound, then there's a reasonable chance. So in many cases we found a good correlation. It's very easy to do antifungal activity. It's very complicated to do antiparasitic activity. So in this area, traditional dealers are not very, very useful. So just to give you some idea, we have 26 publications, antifungal, 20 on antiparasitic, 11 on anti-tick, and 5 publications on anti-fly activity. And quite a bit of research is not used. There's a major problem here. The university wants us to patent stuff. They're quite keen on that. So a guy comes to us and he starts with his PhD study and gets nice results. We get nice results in many, many cases. And then we can't publish the results because the university wants to patent it. And then the student leaves and goes somewhere else and does another job and the thing just stands there. And I've got major ethical problems with this. We use taxpayers' money to do the research. So I've now decided that I'm going to publish all these results. These are longer results. I mean, otherwise it's so totally ridiculous that he does just for the idea. As a matter of fact, we recently, this is a nice story that you'll enjoy, Brighton. We investigated a number of plants for anti-tick activity. And we found Moria had wonderful anti-tick activity. But we got funding with the CSIR. And then CSIR forbid us to publish the Moria. They said, no, we must keep that back because maybe we can patent for the later stage. So they lost the vote. You did the vote before you did. I think there's quite a bit of work that can still come out of this. We also delivered two books. The first was the African Herbal Pharmacopoeia, with good funding from the European Union, ProInvest, and CTA. We identified the 53 most important African species with very wide collaboration from all over Africa, from Europe, from America, from different places. And also had another publication similar to the nice one you gave us here. It was the result of a symposium, the green success stories using Southern Africa's plant extracts. So we also had some other products that we've delivered. This was a nice one. We had collaboration with a small company, and they imported large quantities of grapeseed extract every year to put into the into their products as a good antioxidant compound. And then the guy spoke to me and said, but why, we've got the whole big wine industry, why don't we produce some grape seed extract? So we did a lot of work on this, and the laboratory work is one thing, but then when you go to the industry and you want to scale the whole story up, it's a different story totally. But we were able to resolve all of those problems as well. And then eventually the product was marketed, licensed to Merck Pharmaceuticals. Bioxygen, and the whole idea of marketing is one a day. Because another product that's very popular in South Africa, grape seed extract, Procydon. Procydon, you need 2 tablets per day. So this year had double the activity of Procydon, and we thought that was really fantastic. It was advertised on television and journals everywhere. And then the marketing manager made a slight boo-boo. advertise it before the product was available in pharmacies and the shelves. So at the end of the first quarter, they asked to report on how much money they made. They made nearly nothing because it wasn't available. They tried the marketing manager. The next guy said, I don't want to have anything to do with this toxic product. And then I just gave up in disgust. The other one is a totally different product. The malaria spirit goes just about everywhere where you've got sandy soil. We, in the animal experiment, one of my first PhD students, we found in the animal experiment that just the acetone extract of the leaves of the malaria spirit had better activity against a number of pathogens and better wound healing capacity than gentamicin. And he's a pharmacist, and he had his own pharmacy there. He said, I sell such a lot of gentamicin every day. And then he patented the stuff, actually. And then the big job was to get a formulation that would keep the thing in ointment and everything. So that's one little thing we can be proud of. We got that one for just about everything. Thank you for your attention. And also, some of those my students, it's not my work, it's all the students' work. I'm really in a fortunate position that I've got so many wonderful students from all over Africa coming to us. And I hope that we'll have a good chance of collaborating. That's just what I have to say. Who wants to collaborate? I think we've got a lot of ideas we want to share with you. And we've got the products you can help us to commercialize. Thank you very much. You didn't throw me to the bottle once.
Thank you very much, Kovas, and that's quite a wealth of experience. Can we finalize this session?
I have some questions.
Let's see.
Thank you very much for a nice presentation. I just want to discuss with you a little bit on the endophytes. We are also working on endophytes, and we have a large collection of endophytes. We did the micro extraction, and we did the bioassays against fungal pathogens, but also against insects and nematodes. Okay. And let me tell you, the majority of the activity we find is against insects, although we found some antifungal. But statistically, it seems like the metabolites that we use are mostly active against insects, followed by nematodes, and then fungal pathogens.
Thank you very much. We only recently started looking at endophytes. And I think it's a very exciting area. Someone told us that came from Germany, told us that there's hardly been anything very close been published in Africa on endophytes. So I think it's a very exciting field. To me, as let's say someone that's interested in biochemistry, I'm not too sure. I mean, some people say that endophytes are there to protect the plant against other things. I'm not too sure. Oh, what we did, actually, I forgot that. We collected plants from seven areas, very widely dispersed in the Western Cape. With the idea that if the endophytes enter the plant, how they get there, I'm not sure. And if they play an important role, then we should find differences in plants collected from vast different areas. But there were no difference whatsoever. So maybe the endophytes don't play such an important role. But I'm not sure the endophytes, because these things are maybe 500, 600 kilometers away from each other. Maybe you can help me with that.
We did that kind of experiment. Much further away, we collected medicinal plants, did not find from medicinal plants in Spain and India, which is really far.
Yeah.
And we concluded that most of the biodiversity of endophytes we find is related to the environment, not to the plant species. That's what we concluded. And also, in the Macaronesian forest in the Canary Islands, we have done biodiversity studies on endophytes on one plant species. We find differences in the endophytes from seasonal collections. This is only one plant, one tree.
Yeah.
And we have been collecting seasonally. We found differences in the biota diversity, the microbiota diversity, and then we also found differences within the islands, seven islands, in total in the Canary Islands, and we found different for same plant species. So I think it's mostly environmental.
Thank you very much. It's really such a big detour to go from here to South Africa via Madrid. Otherwise, we would have come to talk a long time with you. Thank you.
Can I just add something to that endophyte story, or a couple of things, actually? I think you're right to be slightly suspicious about endophytes being the new future. I think a lot of people are very excited about the fact that you might be able to use endophytes to make plants naturally resistant to insects. But I think there's a few coincidences that have stimulated the thinking. Another thing that we need to be mindful of with endophytes is the fact that quite a lot of plant chemicals that have been isolated have actually been produced by endophytes growing on the plants. And so that's obviously something that we need to be mindful of when we're isolating. And one famously from our own lab called Swainson, who was extracted from Castanus sperma australis seeds, actually was a fungus growing on the outside of the compound that was produced by. So that's a very important sort of caveat there, I think. But my question is there anything that the agricultural side of commercialization of plant chemicals can learn from the medicinal side of plant chemical use? I suspect from your talk you have more insight into the medicinal exploitation of plant extracts. Are there ways and means that the medicinal applications of plant chemicals could teach the agricultural side of things?
I think there is a big gap because the people, I mean, I had students coming from the part of agriculture, and they were working on this, and because there are certain areas in some of these schools, they are tremendous. Damping off is a Fusarium with major problem with seedings. So there are many examples where these things could have a very good activity. One of the big problems, I didn't stress that really, is this with Melianthus. I think it's probably too toxic. We don't have money to do animal experiments on toxicity, but I now have an agreement with an enormous, one of the biggest rose growers in South Africa, that we're going to test it on roses. So even if it's toxic, there might still be a good application for it somewhere. It might not increase food, but it'll make things look better if we have nice roses.
All right. Last one, please.
Then Andrea, I think.
Okay, I want to just give a comment also on the issue of endophytes. We have also had a chance to isolate quite a number of fungal endophytes from plants. And we have not tested against insects, but we have tested against various plant pathogens and animal and human pathogens. And we have seen some good activity. What you think is that endophytes staying together, living together in a plant, they try to outcompete others, for example. And that's where the activity is coming from, because they mark territory. And it's normal that you have to get the antifungal activity. But what she has said is also interesting to look at.
Thank you very much. I guess the discussion can continue over lunch and even beyond. Can I
just say something? There's one paper that will not be presented, so maybe we can come quarter of an hour later after lunch. The paper by Tanyani Ramatwa is not here in this afternoon session. So you've got 15 minutes to save.
Okay, we'll look into that. Please join in thanking Right, that brings us to the end of this session, a very, very long session. Can I remind the afternoon presenters, please, to bring forward all your presentations and make sure that they are with this gentleman here. And also, for those who still haven't paid, we encourage you to see that gentleman at the back, please. Then posters are there at the back there. I'm sure there might be a few more lying around somewhere. Let's get them up and put them up there, and that will generate some discussion. I'm sure there will be time for people to look at that, because there are a few presenters that are not available either later today or tomorrow afternoon. Oh, yes, you won't be able to eat if you don't see that gentleman there back again. So make sure you talk to him nicely. Thank you very much. Can we resume? This is 20 past. Can we resume at 20 past? Right, 20 past 2 o'clock. Right. 2:20. Yes. 20 minutes past 2.